Hi, everyone, and welcome to Take That With You, your weekly Mavs podcast. I'm Mark Followill, TV voice of the Mavs, emanating live today from Studio 41, Mavs Studio 41 in Dallas. We have an action-packed 50 to 60 minutes of Mavericks basketball to discuss with you. Now, it's a little bit different today. We've had some episodes in the past where I've been remote and Brian has been in studio, but my partner in crime, Brian Dameris, TV analyst on Bally Sports, also co-host of this podcast, radio analyst for the Dallas Mavericks radio broadcast with Chuck Cooperstein. He is in Sacramento. I just saw you waving a moment ago, Brian. Come in, Brian. We welcome you from the capital of the state of California. Hello.
Can you hear me? Can you hear me?
I can, yes. It's weird that you're not here in studio and I'm not remote. This is a little bit different. So how was the trip in from Salt Lake?
Knowing that I am working so hard with the game tonight and you are just going to be sitting with your feet up on the couch because it's a national TV only game.
It's a great
That's why you were back in Dallas.
It's a great feeling. I'm not going to lie. It's a good feeling that you're working tonight and I'm just going to be relaxing and watching and just enjoying some Mavs basketball. Hey, before we get started with all of our good, exciting Mavs content for the week, a reminder that since I'm back in Dallas, I did have to drive down the toll road to get to Mavs Studio 41 today. And NTTA, of course, is the great sponsor of Take That With You. Calling all Mavs fans, you can score now with an official Mavs toll tag. Not only does it keep the Mavs front and center on your windshield, but it cuts your toll bill in half, and the colors are too sweet. Get yours for just $19.99 at getmytolltag.com. Small sticker, big savings. Thanks to NTTA, they have been a faithful supporter and partner and sponsor of Take That With You ever since we left Patreon and came over here to Mavs Studio 41. So, Brian, without further ado, let's jump into what we've got today. And I believe
I've got one quick thing for you.
Yeah, yeah, okay.
So this is my breakfast today, cup of coffee.
Wow, okay.
As you know, they often have late night meals on the plane on the after games. And so
did you not make your bed in the background, by the way?
I didn't. Thank you for pointing that out. I appreciate that. And the lovely room I had. I thought about that as I was looking at the video feed and you just pointed it out to everyone.
So I did. Thanks. That's what I do.
This is the only angle that I could get the light from the window in. So this is kind of how we had to do it.
Yeah. Well, it looks good. The light looks wonderful. It's very, very nice TV lighting.
So I was listening while I was exercising yesterday to The Ticket, and mm-hmm. you were mentioned.
I was.
As they were talking about breakfast. And Gordon threw out, and Junior actually mentioned this, I think one time when you were doing tickers.
I was, yeah.
The question was asked, what were you consuming in there as your breakfast? And I believe they all agreed that it was Munchos, Payday, and a Dr. Pepper. So was that your go-to breakfast back in the late 90s?
Nope. The breakfast was at the cafe that was in the lobby of the building. A few strips, usually like three strips of bacon, a Payday, and probably a soda. So there was protein.
Eat bacon only, a candy bar, and a Dr. Pepper.
Yeah, that was my. But see, the thing about it is, a Payday, of course, has peanuts, a lot of protein. You know, you got your right. protein from the nuts. And then you've got like meat from the bacon, and it's just like it was a office building cafe, and so they didn't give you a ton of breakfast options. And you know, I don't eat eggs very often, so occasionally I will have I will order an omelet light on the egg. I get really weird looks when I say that to the waitress. Can I have an omelet light on the egg, please?
So the main ingredient, yeah.
Yeah, so in other words, instead of three or four eggs, give me one, and then a lot of other right. things like chorizo and peppers and cheese and things like that. So,
Bacon, a Payday, yeah. and Dr. Pepper. That is
yeah.
excellent.
Yeah, I had to get my... It was before I was a big coffee drinker, you know, not like now where I'm a big coffee drinker now. Having my delicious community coffee French vanilla from the Keurig here at the office, so...
Well... Coffee gives you energy. The Mavs don't need any energy, Mark. Start us off here on the continued win streak the Mavs are on.
Yeah, four-game winning streak, and they've won eight of their last nine games, Brian. So let's get into the first thing here. The Mavs with their win last night over Utah, 115-105. You were doing radio with Coop last night, as you'll be doing tonight on 97.1 The Freak and the Dallas Mavericks Radio Network. We were doing the TV broadcast last night, Brian, and then obviously I'm back here in Dallas with the TNT game tonight. But we saw the Mavs beat the Jazz last night by 10. The Mavs have now won 8 out of 9 games since their loss, when we had to come in here when it felt like the world was ending on March the 6th after the Mavs had lost to Indiana on March 5th. About last night's game, and we'll get into it more a little bit later, I did think that the game took on the personality of what I expected it to, which was the Mavs would have to survive an early punch from Utah, who was mad about what happened last week and was back home and had Clarkson and Markkanen playing last night. And they just have to hang on, and ultimately they did that. So, you know, and then assert themselves at the end. So we'll get into that more in a little bit. But this is quite a little streak the Mavs have going right now, Brian, with 8 out of 9 wins, 4 in a row. And when we write the postmortem on the Mavs season, whenever it's over with, I really think we're going to look back in early March, and after losing 5 out of 6 and the way that the Mavs kind of rallied around each other, as a really pivotal time in the season.
Remember where we were after that Indiana loss and the team meeting. I remember doing postgame on Bally, and we didn't have any coach or player interviews. We did a 40-minute postgame show. It was the only time I remember in the time that I've been doing postgame, which means they were having a meeting, and we didn't know at the time, but Jason Kidd was in the meeting. So it wasn't a players-only meeting. It was a team meeting. And Markieff Morris spoke, Kyrie Irving spoke, Jason Kidd spoke. And you and I mentioned this on the pod. Your coach can talk, but you also need your players to talk, and you need your leaders to talk, and your leaders can come in different forms. Markieff Morris is a leader on this team. His vocal leadership, Luka looks up to and appreciates the words that he has to say. Who's the first person that chest bumped with Kyrie after his shot in against Denver?
Yeah.
Markieff Morris.
That's right.
That veteran leadership. You can't have a team be successful without veteran leadership. Kyrie obviously provides that and was a leader in the room, and I think you and I have heard and seen not only what he brings on the court, but what he brings off the court in one-on-one conversations, in group conversations, in mentorship. And then, of course, Jason Kidd spoke. And these were frank discussions. And I said then, this thing can go one of two ways after a meeting like that. It can go down the tubes, or it can go up. And it obviously went up. And the reason it went up is because the chemistry and trust had been built so that the messages sent in that meeting could be heard and trusted. And if you don't have that undergirding of communication, of trust in each other, of having each other's backs, of the relationships being built, of the chemistry in the room, then those discussions can go south quickly. And what it showed was that there's bonding within the team unit, and that this team is responding to its coach because of the relationship that he has with his players and the respect that those players feel for him. Mm-hmm. So when a lot of people are talking about Jason Kidd, keep in mind that that was the inflection point of the season and that they responded well. Remember, these 8 of 9 wins, the only loss was a game Luka didn't play. And
yeah,
they played very competitively against, you know, arguably one of the best teams in the West in Oklahoma City. So, you know, this is a, if he was in that game, maybe even they win that game and you're talking about an unbelievable undefeated stretch. So, you know, to kind of give a big picture, because we're going to talk specifically about how they've won in different ways. These are games, and I had conversations walking into the hotel at midnight last night with people on the team saying, you know, these are games we lose earlier in the season, but they're not losing them now. And that is a testament to how the players are responding and how the coaches are responding. And I think Jason Kidd's talked about it during the losing streak, but people don't want to hear it. Then you can look back on it now. You know, what are you learning during those times that are providing you the mettle and the fortitude for a championship run? And as you said, when you look back at these moments and go, that's where we started learning the lessons that we needed for the run that we went on.
Yeah, I think those are, number one, I applaud your use of the word undergirding. As someone who wrote grad school papers, I did often say that a theory that I had was undergirded by the theoretical framework of something. So I applaud your
That's use. Why you have a master's degree.
I applaud your use of the word undergirding. And I think you hit it all very eloquently, to be perfectly honest with you, Brian. I don't honestly have much more to add to it. I think you nailed it in all those regards. And I think that part of it is the intangible, psychological, mental, emotional part of what's happened over the course of the last 9 games. And then there's the strategic physical basketball nature of what happened over the last nine games. And the other part of that inflection point that you're talking about after the Indiana game was not just, hey, let's have a meeting and let's have the airing of the grievances, if I may make a Festivus reference there. Let's talk it out and let's get.
And it wasn't even an airing of grievances. It was just here's what we, we're capable of this. Here's what we need to do to get right on the right page. It wasn't a pointing fingers kind of discussion from the reporting, from the info we've been able to gather from that.
Yeah. So I think that, that's the psychological aspect of it. We also said in here on that podcast that day, and I said at the time, Brian, and you agreed with this, that there were things that the Mavs could do to change what they were doing from a playing standpoint, and that was lineup changes and rotation changes. And obviously the change of Gafford and Jones into the starting lineup has been big, and that's been part of this stretch. And as we said at the time, and I wrote this down, I thought this was pretty interesting as well, Brian. I checked on this morning just to make sure I had my facts right on this. We said that they needed to play big as much as they possibly could. So Gafford start, Lively come in, and the goal to me was get those guys to play a combined 40 to 44 minutes a game. Lively was unavailable for the Detroit game. He missed due to personal reasons. But in the eight games that Gafford and Lively have been available, since the starting lineup change and what has amounted to a rotation change, these are the combined minutes for Gaff and Lively. 44, 43, 46, 40, 47, 40, 43, and 45 last night. So a starting lineup
that makes Followill happy.
Yeah, it does. It absolutely. It makes your buddy on the radio broadcast, Chuck Cooperstein, very happy as well. I think that's been a critical part of where they are defensively and what they do on the offensive end of the floor with the pick and roll game and the hard roller and the way the center finishes inside. And we'll have more on that coming up as the podcast unfolds today. But the emotional aspect that you touched on and then the strategic basketball aspect really have combined to make this as you said, an inflection point in the season, and they've completely turned it around.
Well, let's take a look at what specifically they've done, because they've won in different ways, even in the last three games.
Yeah.
And something Jason Kidd said pregame yesterday I thought was really interesting, in that he was like, you've got to win in multiple different ways because you never know what matchups you're going to get in the playoffs.
Yeah.
And if you're just one dimensional, and you and I have talked about this, the plan B when the shots don't fall, how are you going to be able to get into a street fight? Can you get into a track meet? Can you slow it down and play half court? All of those kinds of things. Can you play physical? Can you play big? Can you play small? This team is now capable of doing that. They're not one-dimensional anymore, and they've shown that recently.
Yeah, so I think if we work backwards, it's a long season. To your point and Jason Kidd's point, games require different ways to go about winning them. So let's discuss last night. Let's work backward over the last three wins since the last time you and I had a podcast recording, Brian. Last night, 115-105. Mavs rally for this win in Utah, and a lot of our talking points at the beginning of the telecast last night focused on the pride that Utah would have, because surely they did not like the performance they had here in Dallas, where they got dunked on 18 times the other night. So there would be some pride and a bounce back, and the Mavericks had to go to Salt Lake City, where they won only two of the last 15 regular season games with last night's victory. I thought the characteristics that sort of defined last night, showing some resolve, staying connected early, withstanding a big punch, and then kind of dialing in on both ends of the floor, Brian, offensively and defensively as the game unfolded. And then they were able to step forward and bring it over the finish line in the end. So, the game began with, not a very good defensive start for Dallas, and also not a terribly good offensive start, at least from the two key components of the offense, Luka and Kyrie. Neither one were shooting well and scoring much in the first quarter of the game. And so in steps a guy who's been amongst a lot of MFFLs, and I certainly understand the angst about it, but a lot of people have viewed Tim Hardaway Jr. As persona non grata lately with the slump that he's been in. But he came out, Harp said it on our broadcast, he had watched him at shoot around how well he was shooting the ball. He said, I don't think there's anything mechanically wrong with how he's shooting. Sometimes things just get stuck up here between the ears and it's hard to kind of flush that. But Hardaway came out last night. He didn't sustain this for the whole game, but the burst of 11 points in the first quarter, Brian, was vital to keeping Dallas connected.
Yeah, contributions from different players. We saw in the San Antonio game, this team learned to win when Luka was not having a superhuman night. He still had an 18-point triple-double, But you know, they needed other players to step up, and we'll talk about that. But they took those lessons, and in that first quarter, Utah was going to bounce back. They obviously, you know, didn't like the way they played Thursday night in that game, and we'll get into that in a bit. But they were going to come in and give their best punch at home. And the Mavericks gave up a 40-point quarter for the first time, I believe, since the Orlando game in January. So defensively, they weren't there. Utah was running the same blueprint against us in terms of lobs and dunks, attacking the paint, that kind of thing. And interestingly, something we're going to see more, I think, and Itzhak Franco in his D Magazine piece, which came out this morning, talked about it, and Jason Kidd talked about it yesterday in his radio interview with Coop, is that we're going to see teams sag off our shooters in the corners and try to stop that vertical game and make that a little bit harder. And that wasn't there as effectively as it was in the first time we played Utah, which made it a little bit harder. Packing that paint made Luka's shots, made Kyrie's shots a little more difficult. That's what we saw in the first quarter. And other players are going to have to step up in that void, either hitting those outside shots because they're open, or which is what Hardaway did with those leading scoring points in the first quarter. I don't know how many he had in that first quarter.
11 in the first
11.
Quarter. Yep.
But, you know, that was vital to staying in the game so that when the big shots, you know, when Kyrie and Luka were able to really step it up in the third, then you could, you know, you were within striking distance. So, you know, Hardaway played a really key role later in the game. He had three steals in the fourth quarter, played really well on that end of the floor as well.
Four assists in the second half. Yeah. Didn't score, you know, went 5 for 7 from the floor in the first half, 0 for 7 from the floor in the second half. So didn't sustain the shooting, but did help in other ways. And that is always what you have to do. If you're not going to score, you've got to find other ways to contribute to the team. And last night that was the case. And I thought, you know, the other thing that happened as the game evolved last night was not only dialing in and getting better offensively when Luke and Kyrie didn't have a great start to the game, but they dialed in defensively. To your point a minute ago, a 41-point first quarter, they surrendered. But then moving forward the rest of the game, Brian, they gave up 25 in the second, 22 in the third, 17 in the fourth. You know, Markkanen had a great start to the game. By the way, last night, just the second time all year, in 10 games when Markkanen has scored 30-plus that the Jazz have lost. He scored 34 last night. But I think probably the key thing that happened is, you know, the paint protection got better, and the Mavs were able to, and maybe some of this is Utah's own immaturity, for lack of a better term, as a team, but also the fact that, you know, they got away from Markkanen and Sexton and Collins and those guys being the focal point, and you had stretches of time where Keontae George is taking some ill-advised shots, or Taylor Hendricks, or Sensabaugh off the bench, or Johnny Juzang, who didn't make a shot in 13 minutes played last night. There just wasn't they weren't able to sustain what happened in terms of Markkanen and Sexton and those guys throughout the course of the game. So Dallas's defense dialed in and the second and the third quarter, especially with the Gafford blocks and things along those lines.
Well, after giving up that 40-point first quarter, they gave up 39 points in the second half.
Yeah.
And going into the game yesterday, since the trade deadline, this team is 15th in defensive efficiency. You and I have talked a lot about how that's the number. Play average-level defense, and with what this offense is capable of doing, you're going to win ball games. And lo and behold, that has been it. And as they've played this new bigger lineup with PJ Washington, with Jones, and with one of the centers in the lineup, then that's where the defensive numbers have gotten better on the wings and inside because of the rim protection and the perimeter defense being so improved and the paint protection. So, you know, that's the blueprint. And this is kind of the way Jason Kidd wants to play. I remember writing an article last year in D Magazine, let's lean into becoming the James Harden Rockets because that's who we are, and just spread it around, shoot the threes, try to outscore everybody because that's the personnel you had. You had to play to your personnel. Well, now, because of the great work that Nico has put together in terms of what we did at the deadline, getting longer, bigger, more athletic, you can now play diverse styles, and you can play this bigger lineup. I mean, look at what happened in that Denver game when Nikola Jokic is going, they were bigger than us.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not something that we've been able to say previously. So, you know, that's the model. And listen, the three ball has not been falling. I think the three ball will fall. Another thing Jason Kidd said yesterday was, you know, you want to be shooting really well at the beginning of the year, and you want to be shooting really well at the end of the year. And, you know, they've been putting a lot of emphasis on the defensive side of the ball here lately since the trade. They've been trying some new things. It's worked well, but that has put some pressure mentally and physically, and maybe the legs just aren't there yet for some of those players. And once they kind of plow through this, that once we get to that last week of the season and into the playoffs, that three ball will start. And then imagine what this team is like when they're able to attack the paint and do what they've done recently in terms of the twos. And then you're adding the three ball on top of that with your improved defense. That's a really dangerous team.
Well, and the good news is that the three ball last night, although it was for the whole game 28%, 12 out of 42, there was an important burst of making three-point shots, a couple by Luka, a flourish by Kyrie in the third quarter. You know, those guys were the closers, not just in the fourth quarter, but really you could say in the third quarter last night as the Mavericks kind of started to grab control of this game. You know, they got up off the mat, they fell behind in the first half, and then in the third quarter they go in front because of that burst of three-point shooting, and then they turn to their closers in the fourth quarter as well. Now, it wasn't three-point shooting by Luka and Kyrie. P.J. Washington made the key threes in the fourth quarter, but Luka
And how great was it to see to have him make a couple of corner threes, and we want to see more of that, and maybe that could spur something.
You know, it was 94-93, the last time that Utah led last night with 10 minutes approximately left in the game, and then it was a 22-11 run by Dallas to close the game, and Brian, in that stretch of time, Luka had 8, Kyrie had 4, PJ had 6. So, you know, there's the majority of your points in that stretch. I believe Gafford had a dunk and Kleba had a dunk to round out the 22 points in that 22-11 run. So it was stay connected, stay the course, show some resolve, and then be in position to turn it over to your closers against a much less experienced team who doesn't have clearly the fourth quarter closers that Dallas has in Luka and Kyrie Irving.
But you got to beat the teams you're supposed to beat. Yeah. And they took care of that business. You know, that's what championships teams do. They protect their home court. They play, you know, 500 or better ball on the road, and they beat the teams they're supposed to beat.
Yeah, and last night was a nice road win. By the way, starting a 5-game road trip, and I do believe there is something, in my opinion, and Jay Kidd, it seemed like he agreed. You heard the answer to my question last night. I think He didn't exactly phrase it the way I did, but I think that there was some agreement there that, yeah, the first game of a long road trip does set a tone. I do believe in that, and the Mavericks set a good tone last night. So as we work backwards about these kind of different ways they've won games, Brian, let's go to last Thursday's game. Remember, they had the whole weekend off. Last Thursday, the Mavericks beat the Jazz at home, throwing a dunk party. Brian, I don't know if you got your invite to this party and if you RSVP'd. As I said on the broadcast, Daniel Gafford was the bouncer at this party last week because he had 10 of the 18 dunks, which was easily the team record.
Are you trying to change his nickname from the landlord
to the bouncer? I haven't thought about that, but you might be onto something there. I kind of like that. So it's the It's the team record, 18 dunks, tied for the second most in the NBA in the play-by-play era since 1996. And by the way, our great Studio 41 crew with the work of Chopper put together a video last week. I tweeted it, and it's available on the Mavs YouTube channel. Dunks are fun. A long-form look at all 18 dunks in the game last week. It was fun, Brian. It was fun to broadcast it. Fun for the fans to watch it. That was one of our Channel 8 games last week. So, you know, I had a big number watching the game, and it was not all Gafford, but predominantly P.J. Washington. Kyrie finished an alley-oop in there as well. Derrick Jones Jr. had a highlight reel dunk because it was the exclamation point on Luka diving to the floor to get a loose ball, and then from his butt throwing the ball up ahead to Kyrie, who then lobbed it for Derrick Jones Jr. And it was just an absolutely unforgettable and tremendously enjoyable performance that the Mavs had in that 113-97 win.
Mark, I don't know if you remember 1983, the semifinals between Louisville and the Houston Cougars.
Yeah.
Which was an absolute dunk fest, actually, by both teams. One of the best college basketball games ever played that Houston won before eventually losing to NC State in that, of course, famous play there with Jim Valvano and Lorenzo Charles and all of that. But that was the birth of Phi Slamma Jamma.
That's right.
And, of course, with March Madness starting on that day, I referenced that on the broadcast.
Yeah,
and,
I like that a lot.
Yeah, Phi Slamma Mava, but as I try to call it. But That was an amazing performance because it wasn't just like showboat, you know, slam dunking. It was part of what they were doing. They were this is one of the best plays there, where Luka on his back finds Kyrie, who then finds Jones, I believe it is, for Air Jones
land,
you know, takeoff. Yep. That and of course the Luka to Kyrie were the two, you know, ultimate highlights of that whole thing there in that game. But it showed pace. They were getting that in pace. They were getting it in their half court offense, which of course that pick and roll game with the bigs is what is the genesis of their whole half court offense. That amazing pass, the no look passes from Luka are just amazing. Everybody getting in on the act. You know, this is why earlier I talked about, you know, defenses now sagging off guys, you know, to try to stop exactly what happened there, because that is such a potent aspect of this team now. And this is an athletic team that can do that. You know, it'll be interesting to see if we see defenses start adjusting and trying to take away some of that vertical game and some of that. They can't take away, obviously, what we do in transition. But, you know, in terms of the half court offense, are you going to see that happen until, you know, we punish them with making those open threes?
Yeah, the Mavs had, I mean, another game of great shooting in the paint last night, 28 out of 38. This was a 60-plus point game in the paint. We're seeing the Kyrie alley-oop. You know, I loved when we were getting a chance just a moment ago to look at the highlights, and I hadn't seen this before. There was an overhead camera angle of the Derrick Jones Jr. slam dunk, and you could see the way Daniel Gafford was, like, flexing. He was standing right there, and when Jones was dunking, Gafford was sitting there flexing. So I think, you know, the thing about that is the team and the guys, they feed off one another when you're having a game like that. Yes. And a performance like that. So,
I mean, you know, the interesting point on that from last night's game, you saw in the fourth quarter, Kyrie Irving diving into the stands for a loose ball.
Yeah.
You saw in the fourth quarter, Luka Doncic taking a charge late in the game at an important point of the game. When the team sees their superstars sacrificing their body and making those kinds of plays, everybody steps up. Mm-hmm. And so the Gaffords and Joneses and Maxies and everybody else, well, if he's going to do that, I'm going to go put out all the effort I can as well. And that's just like, even on positive, you know, it's on those kind of hustle plays, and it's on, you know, Gafford loving the excitement and energy that Jones has when he has that dunk, and they all want to, you know, be a part of that, and that builds that chemistry and bonding that they have.
You know, last night's game, or that game last Thursday, I'm sorry, was the latest example of winning a different way. But really, that game in the last week is the best example of it. But there have been a lot of games. The Chicago game on the road is another example. The Mavs are winning games now because of their prowess in the paint, and because they are such lethal finishers in the pick and roll with Gafford and Lively, and Washington and Jones contribute to that as well, of course, with their ability to finish. Going into yesterday's game, Brian, since the trade deadline, the Mavs are shooting 63% on their shots in the paint. That went up last night because they were 28 of 38 on shots in the paint last night. Just to give you an example, since 96-97, the Miami Heat are the best team ever in a season to shoot in the paint, and that was approximately 63%, just shy of 63% back in the last year of the Heatles era, 2013-14, when they went to the finals and lost to San Antonio. So this is really heady stuff when, you know, for a quarter of your season now, essentially, or very close to it anyway, at least 20%, the Mavs have shot 63% on their shots in the paint. And that's a huge component of that game and the way that they're winning a lot of games because of what they can do in the paint and around the basket.
And they need that because since the starting lineup change in the nine games where they won 8 of 9, the only loss being when Luka didn't play,
yeah,
they're shooting 32% from three.
Yeah.
In six of those games, they've shot under 33%. So these are games they absolutely just put an L by beforehand,
yeah,
when they don't have the ability to penetrate and get these points in the paint and play that aggressively and get that running game going.
Yeah, and I mentioned this in the Hardline last week. You know, I think, and you brought up three-point shooting and, you know, how much is fatigue-related because of an intensified focus and a lot being asked of the guys on the defensive end of the floor right now. But going into today's action, the Atlanta Hawks have moved into the top half of the league in three-point percentage. They're the only team in the league with a losing record that is in the top half of the NBA in three-point percentage. 14 of the top 15 teams in three-point percentage have winning records. There's only two teams that have winning records that are in the bottom 10 in the league in three-point percentage, the Orlando Magic and the Houston Rockets now, by the way, because of their hot streak, are over 500 at 36 and 35. So the point of that is, over the long haul, three-point shooting is a barometer of success in general. And it's not about the number of attempts, because, Brian, there's a lot of good teams, Denver, New Orleans, Phoenix, you know, teams like that. And I know Phoenix had a squirrely loss last night, but Phoenix is, you know, 10 games over 500. You know, there are a lot of well over 500 teams, Minnesota being another one. You know, the Lakers aren't very far over 500, but that's another example of a plus 500 team. They're all at the bottom of the league in attempts. So it's not necessarily about, do you have to take 40 a night like Boston is, but you do need to be making them over the long haul at an average clip. So we love the dunks. We love the points in the paint. It's great that that is a very reliable club in the Mavericks bag now. But before it's all said and done, Brian, they're going to have to get the three-point shooting situation sorted out and get back to average.
This team going into last night's game was third in field goal attempts from three. As a percentage of their shots, so or overall. And so that, you know, they do, that's part of their identity. I firmly believe the three-point shot is going to come back. I think it will regress back to the mean. These are players who can hit that effectively. Obviously, the return of Josh Green will help that as well. But I think that what they're learning and the skills of learning how to win this way will be greatly benefit this team once the three-point shooting comes back and they can play both ways. I don't believe this is like the new way that the Mavs are just going to be a poor three-point shooting team. This is who they are going forward. I think that the shooting will get better from three.
Well, to culminate the weekend review before we get on to other topics, one more different way of winning, Brian, was what happened a week ago tonight when the Mavs played down in San Antonio. This was a teammates pickup Luka Doncic game. Luka had the worst field goal percentage in a game in his career since his rookie season at 6 out of 27, 22% from the floor. But Kyrie Irving, on the heels of his unreal, unbelievable, unforgettable game winner against the Denver Nuggets, really carried the mail on offense, making 13 two-pointers in the game. He didn't make any threes, but he was 13 of 16 on two-point shots in that game. And as you're seeing on our Studio 41 highlights right now, if you're watching on YouTube, of course, you can listen on iTunes and Spotify and wherever else you get your podcasts from an audio standpoint. But check out the great videos and graphics if you watch on YouTube. And we're seeing Dante Exum hit some late threes in the game. So whenever the game was over with, Jason Kidd said last week that Luka came into the locker room and thanked his teammates for picking him up. Even though he only went 6 for 27 from the floor, as you accurately pointed out earlier, Brian, he still had a triple-double in the game. He had, what, 16 assists, I believe, was the assist number. He grabbed his 10th rebound at the very end. But in terms of shooting efficiency, Kyrie Irving really picked things up for the Mavericks, and then Exum asserted himself late in the game with two clutch threes to make him 6 of 7 on NBA-designated clutch time threes this year, by the way.
By the way, Luka has 75 triple-doubles after last night. Yeah. He's one behind James Harden for eighth all time.
Yeah.
This early in his career. And you're right. It was good that the Mavs won a game where they didn't have to rely on Luka to score 20-plus points, and he was able to be effective in other ways. And, oh, by the way, he's still a magnet for the defense. They still have to pay attention to him. And that you know, even when he wasn't shooting well, you still have to put bodies on him, which opens things up for things like Maxey making the right extra pass to Exum to hit that basically dagger three from the corner there in the fourth. And Exum is now playing at the most improved player level Exum that he was before the injury in the early part of the season, October, November, and December, being that connector, being that runner, being that downhill player, being that long defender, and being that secondary playmaker, running the team to give Luka or Kyrie some possessions off when he's playing with just one of them on the court. And, of course, you know, shooting 50% from three, way above where he was earlier in his career.
Yeah, his best three-point shooting percentage in a season in his career is 35%, and Dante's right at 50%. And the other thing that came out of that game, too, you know, you don't just pick up a bad night by Luka by who else scores, but you mitigate the need for as much scoring by playing good defense. And I thought that was a really big story from the game, because that was Victor Wembanyama's worst field goal percentage in his rookie season, 23% from the floor, 3 of 13. I'm sure we have to give the qualifier. He missed some shots that he normally makes. However, I thought between Gafford, PJ Washington, PJL, he put him in PJL in that particular game.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Okay.
I've seen
some
people.
Are you test-marketing that?
Okay. I've seen some people saying that online. Lively had a block shot in the game against Wembanyama as well. I thought the Mavs did some really nice things defensively, challenging shots against Wimby or forcing him to take some, to settle for some outside shots rather than go at them. Wimby looked different than he did to me in the game here in Dallas right before the All-Star break. He had a really good game the game before, Brian, against Brooklyn. That was the 30-something points, 15 rebounds, 7 assists, 7 blocks. But his numbers shooting the ball overall, and especially from the outside, had been trending down for a 4 or 5 game stretch before that Brooklyn game. And then he had a really good game against Brooklyn, and then the shooting numbers were back down low against Dallas with a 3 for 13. So maybe some of that is him. But I thought credit must be given to the Mavs defense and their performance in that game as well.
Well, there's obviously a rookie wall that, you know, Lively plowed through, and you're getting the end of the season and a lot of losing there for San Antonio. You mentioned P.J. Washington on defense. I don't think he's getting near enough credit that he should, and that may be taking a little bit out of him, what he's doing offensively, although offensively he's still able to get in that little paint area and around the dotted line and get those nice little floaters in. But we should give him credit for what he's doing defensively, because he was on, as you mentioned, Wimby a lot there too.
Yeah.
You had to have other players. Kyrie, again, was playing a phenomenal game and picking up some slack, but you had to have, and I mentioned on the broadcast before Exum hit his shots, I said, somebody else other than those two is going to have to hit a shot. And Exum was there to do it. He's just been a really key piece, closing some games as that, you know, I talked about it in my D Magazine article, kind of previewing what this team was going to be after the break, how they kind of, what these next 25 games were going to look like and what the point of all that was. And we knew that you're going to have your center position and who was going to start and close and all that. You got your two studs and then those wings and you know, which of those group of wings is going to close on a nightly basis, depending on how they're playing. And Exum's making a really strong case that he should be in that, and also his ability to play that third playmaker.
Well, he certainly contributed with scoring late in the Miami game that got this whole stretch of games started where they've won 8 of 9, and he was instrumental with the threes that he hit down the stretch against San Antonio. So, Brian, that's a look back at the week that was, but there's still a lot to talk about, because I think that all of this winning 8 of 9, this 4-game winning streak, the week that it was, et cetera, I think there's one person that's a big contributor to this that we need to get into here, and that's let's talk a little Daniel Gafford. Last night, Brian, you, of course, were with the team flying to Sacramento after the game. As I was getting ready to go back to the hotel, I talked for a little bit with your esteemed colleague, Chuck Cooperstein, the radio voice of the Mavs. And, I mean, you know, we're both in agreement. What Gafford is doing and what he's going to be capable of doing moving forward has really changed the calculus of what's possible for this team. Now, obviously, Luke and Kyrie are the fulcrum of the offense, and we know how important those guys are. And, you know, you're not going anywhere if those guys aren't playing at or near the top of their game. But then, as Nico said last year, when things didn't go well at the end of the season, Luke and Kyrie can work together, but you've got to get the right pieces around them. And the acquisition of Daniel Gafford is just an incredible fit around Luka and Kyrie. So there's several things I want to get into here with Gafford. The first thing is, let's talk about field goal percentage, Brian, because Daniel Gafford, as of last night, he made 6 out of 7 shots last night, Brian. That puts him at 300 field goals made precisely. Now, why am I bringing that up? Because that's the minimum number that you have to make in an 82-game regular season to qualify for the league-leading field goal percentage. So Gafford is a qualifier now for the end of the season league lead in field goal percentage. He's at 71.6%, leads the NBA right now, quite obviously. 6 percentage points better, Brian, than Ivica Zubac of the Clippers. And Gafford at this point is on track to become the first Maverick to lead the NBA in field goal percentage for a season. So to me, that's really exciting. You know, and he's going to be in a very select group of people. I think, you know, at this point, it's likely he's going to finish over 70%. Mitchell Robinson, Rudy Gobert, Wilt Chamberlain, DeAndre Jordan, those four guys, and now potentially Gafford are the only players to be qualifiers and shoot over 70% from the floor in a regular season. I mean, it's just incredible what he's come in here and done from a finishing around the basket standpoint.
During a recent 10-game stretch, he shot 90%, and he's the only player in NBA history with at least 50 field goal attempts in that 10 in a 10-game stretch to shoot 90% or more. Obviously, he had that great consecutive make streak. Obviously, all the dunks. He had 10 dunks in that Utah game himself.
Yeah.
Helped. You know, when you look at that Gafford deal, and I got to credit you, you were a fan of his for a long time.
A long time, bro.
And really knew that that was, if you went to a lab and built the prototypical big man to play with Luka, Lively and Gafford would come out because they're that athletic, rim-running big that he likes to play with because of everything that that vertical game brings you. And of course, the rim protection and adjustment of shots that he brings on the defensive end. And when you look at the deal that was made for Gafford, there was a lot of hand-wringing from some national people because of what was given up. But I go back to what Nico said at the Kyrie press conference when he was introduced, and that the risk is not doing it. And yeah, there's a cost to everything, but Nico knew what this team needed. I mean, he wanted to have that kind of presence for 48 minutes or 40 plus minutes, as you pointed out. And he knew what that kind of person brought to this team and wanted it unlocked on both ends and how important that is. And, you know, that's why you do that kind of deal. And what a front office is supposed to do is find the players that are in situations where they're not being maximized and going, you know what? In this situation, I think we can unlock the best of that player and get the most out of them. Same with PJ Washington. And so that's why you do those deals. And you know, look, it happened with Spencer Dinwiddie. He really became the best version of himself when he got here after a situation where it wasn't the best fit for him in Washington. That's what smart front offices do. And that's why those deals work a lot of times. You buy low and really because of what you're able to do with your organization, your scheme, your players around you, make that person the best version. Now, a lot of teams are going, man, look, we didn't even think about that with Gafford.
So, and by the way, and it's not just a rental too. You know, he's under contract for 2 more years after this. So that's
a really 25
component. Yeah. And that's a great thing as well. And he's doing more than just being a dominant force, the tower of power in the middle, because the other thing that he's doing is blocking shots, key role last night, 5 block shots. And how about the ability to get involved setting other people up, whether it's as the quarterback at the nail in the short roll? We just saw a kick out pass to Jaden Hardy for a three in the highlight package that's being shown right now. Another opportunity, it's not exactly a short roll of the nail, but catching the ball inside and going out. There's been some offensive rebounds and kickouts. There's been a variety of ways that he's had assists, but he's had 5 assists in both of these games against Utah, Brian, which ties his career high. And then he coupled 5 assists with 5 blocks and a point rebound double-double last night as well. So he is helping the Mavs in a variety of different ways. And I think the really exciting thing, you know, I don't want the guy to be like, I mean, I'm not expecting him to be Sabonis, for example, who the Mavs will see tonight in terms of that level of a passing big man or Jokic. But the fact that he's had back-to-back 5 assist games is super exciting and a new wrinkle to the Mavs offense.
Those last two we just showed are the ones I like a lot when he's at the top of the key and he's finding the big to small assist right there down low. Mm-hmm. You know, those are new wrinkles. And remember what I talked about where I talked about people sagging off and tagging him as he's rolling. You know, if that happens more often, then he needs to be a distributor out of that. And that's what he's doing now. And so that's important for him to be able to recognize and find the open person, still be a threat to attack the basket on his own, as Jason Kidd talked to you pregame about it on that short roll, but also being able to find the open person when he has to do that. So those 5 assists in the last 2 games are huge, and he needs to be able to do that because, you know, there's going to be now defensive wrinkles as teams are scouting what the Mavs are doing with Lively and Gafford as they're rolling and getting these dunks and getting that vertical game going. They're going to start defending them with wings. And being able to say, okay, well, I'm not going to let you play the pick and roll game because I know Luka wants to play the pick and roll game with a big. I'm going to put a wing on your big, take him out of it. And now Jones is going to have to play that role. So Jones is going to come in because they're going to put the big on Jones, right? Saying that's the easiest bet for them defensively. Jones is going to have to come in the pick and roll. He's going to have to be that roller or distributor as well. So that's the chess match that we're finding as teams adjust to what you're doing, then you adjust, and they have to adjust to that.
Well, the defense, of course, is something that we expected to see out of Gafford, and we saw it again with the 5 block shots that he had last night. Gafford is going to end up finishing in the top 10 in the league in block shots per game going into play last night. He was 8th at 2 blocks per game between the Wizards and the Mavs this year. And then no discussion of Gafford can be had without talking about his buddy Derek Lively, who now is playing a very effective role off the bench. And, Brian, we've had a lot of hand-wringing. You used that term a little bit ago. We've had some hand-wringing here about, okay, how are the Mavs going to augment what Luka and Kyrie do on offense with a third scorer? And, we talked about, could it be by committee? Is it going to be Hardaway? Is it going to be Washington? And I think the thing that we have arrived at here in this recent stretch is the center position is the third scorer. Because I believe in the 8 games where Lively and Gafford have played these big minutes together, again, Lively missed the Detroit game in this stretch of the last 9. So it's 8 games that Gafford and Lively have played 40-plus minutes combined. And in those 8 games, I'm sorry, 7 games, they're scoring. I see it on the graphic on the screen on the lower third there. Last 7 games, those guys are averaging over 26 points per game. I mean, that's a pretty damn good third scorer, Brian.
I believe it was the San Antonio game where they were doing, exactly what you're kind of seeing there on the floor. And I turned to Coop during the broadcast and I said, we've been looking for our third scorer. I think it's the center position. And he goes, you know what? You're right. And that's kind of where it just, dawned on me. Like it's been right in front of us
the whole
time.
Hello, McFly.
Right. And so that is huge for this team to be able to get that kind of production from the centers. And then once one of your wings, whether it's PJ Washington, whether it's Tim Hardaway and what he was able to do, whether it's Exum, is able to step up and provide even additional scoring, then that's just gravy on top of that. But, there's no reason to think that we can't get this level of scoring. Again, there's going to be different things defenses are going to try to do to take that away. But even last night when Utah tried to do that, they were really effective and combined for, 13 for Gafford and Lively had 6 and they had 19, last night in that game. And that's, if you're getting that kind of production from your center position, not to mention the blocks, assists, rebounds, et cetera, offensive rebounding and what you're getting, the second chance opportunities that Gafford and Lively provide you that you just weren't able to have, the rebounding advantage. We won the rebounding battle again last night. But yes, I think the consistent third scorer can be your center. And then you still are able to get something from some wings as well. It's amazing when you look back a year ago to what this team is, and even earlier in the season before the trade deadline, how things have changed, and this is why they're winning games.
Okay, so Brian, we got like about 12, 13 minutes to go here, so we've got 3 topics we need to cover before the end. One of them to me is the continuing growth of the Lukai chemistry. They're now 28-15, the Mavericks are, in games that Luka and Kyrie have both played this year. I think this is a good time to bring this up, Brian, not just because of the overall record, by the way, 28-15, that's essentially winning close to 65% of their games. That's about 53 wins over the course of a season, just to give you an understanding of how well this team flows and the kind of level they are capable of playing at when Luka and Kyrie are healthy with a 28-15 record in the games that they played. But a lot's happened, Brian, since our last podcast, whether it was, you and I seeing up close and personal the vibe between all of the guys, not just Luka and Kyrie, at Mavs Ball on Friday night, the great fundraiser where the whole team was, raised over $1.8 million for the Mavs Foundation. That was really awesome. But, Mark Stein had a great article over the weekend for his Substack about the way Kyrie has flourished here in Dallas, and big props to his relationship with Jason Kidd and Nico Harrison being part of that. As you know, Brian, Brad Townsend wrote an article on this. You and I are all aware of this as well, that a lot's come to light in the last week about what the Mavericks are doing and putting things in place to support Kyrie, and something that's very important, practicing his faith and observing the fasting of Ramadan, which is now about a week and a half old, or getting close to 2 weeks old now at this point, Ramadan is. So, you know, Kyrie, his fasting and what's happened around that has been a big story as well. And the support that the Mavericks are giving to him in this very, very special spiritual time. And I think that Luka just seems like at this point as well, with, you know, he's coming in the locker room and saying, thanks, guys, for picking me up after a tough game last week. I think we're seeing just every day it seems like there's another piece to the puzzle that's indicative of how these guys are fitting together better and better from beyond just a basketball standpoint. The basketball is great, but what makes the basketball standpoint work is the great things that are happening on a personal level and on a teammate level between the two guys.
If you don't have that chemistry off the court, you can't have it on the court.
Yeah. And yeah. I mean, the 90s Pistons that won titles, Brian, I remember seeing Bill Laimbeer say a long time ago, I know that, that he's an interesting guy to quote, but I do think he's right on this. Championships were won on the plane, on the bus, in the locker room, not necessarily on the floor, to your point.
Yeah, if you ask any players left the game, what they miss most are those moments. And the two great players were going to find a way to work together, and they're not playing my turn, your turn. They're playing symbiotic basketball with each other and with their teammates. And you saw it again last night where Luka's finding Kyrie in the corner. They're each know what the tendencies are, when somebody needs a breather, when it's their turn, where they like to be, the alley-oops to each other that you saw in the first Utah game. They're now becoming that 1+1=3 combination. Kyrie, as Mark Stein pointed out, hasn't felt this good about playing with a teammate since LeBron James days when they won a championship. And so, you know, the both of them together are realizing that they make each other even better. And that combination is becoming so powerful. And I guarantee you that opposing coaches and teams don't want to see either of these guys in a playoff series. And the Dallas is taking teams' best punches right now because of that. And they'll be taking best punches in the playoffs. But nobody wants to see what these two are capable of. Because even last night is an example. Even when one or two of them may start slowly, we know that eventually they're going to do what they do. Talent will out, and it's going to become really tough for teams to win when they're playing together as optimally as they are.
Yeah, I mean, it speaks to them as people and their desire to win and their appreciation of one another's talent. And the other part of the equation is it speaks to the J. Kidd and Nico, because they've got the right things in place to let those guys flourish as people, to let them flourish as basketball players. And as was said many times last offseason, they can work. Now the goal is put the right pieces around them. And Dallas has put a lot of pieces, the front office put a lot of really good pieces around them. And so that's why they're 28-15 and when those two guys play together. And that's why this team is at a higher point over 500 than they've been all year long. They're at 42-29. As we do our weekly update of the standings, Brian, in the Western Conference, here we go. The Spurs beat the Suns last night. Phoenix is now eighth, sitting in seventh. The Mavericks at 42-29, sitting in sixth at 42-29. The Kings, the Clippers, and Pelicans. That's getting really interesting at 4-5 right now, by the way. And the Rockets are making a move to get themselves back into play-in tournament conversation as well, lurking behind the Golden State Warriors and the Los Angeles Lakers, the Warriors 10th, the Lakers 9th. So there are the standings. It is crazy, Brian, that I guess it was Saturday night or Sunday night, whatever night it was, that the Mavs didn't play, but because of the other results, they went from 6th to 8th in one night, even when they didn't play because of what happened in other games. And they got into the weird three-way tie situation, which not favor them, by the way.
Well, go into that. What is the three-way tie scenario?
A three-way tie is head-to-head record between the three teams and games played against each other. So
okay,
I'd have to look and see how Phoenix and Sacramento have done against each other. And I think they play each other one more time, too, in the final week of the season as well. But, yeah, you would look at If there was, if it came down to a three-way tie, and we don't know what it's going to look like yet with the two games that Dallas has to play against the Kings and the Kings and Suns playing each other, but you would look at the best record in the three games against each other and the round-robin games against each other, and that's how you would determine the winner of a three-way tie. So we'll analyze that a little bit more closely. If it looks like it's realistic, let's get through this week and kind of see where we are.
Well, that's the point. Yeah. So if you look at 6 and 7, obviously you're tied. And yep. You're in seventh because we're 0-2 to the Kings. And I'm sitting here in a Sacramento hotel with an unmade bed because you've got two huge games. These are, you know, it's you can't even overstate. These are the two biggest games of the season right now for the Mavericks.
Yes.
You want to get, I think if you can get even one of these, you put yourself in a really good position. Now, obviously, two of them ties you in the series, and then you can get into, you know, the ramifications of tiebreakers from there. But
well,
even
just,
one.
Just to tell you real quick on that, Brian, if the Mavs won these two games, the Mavs and Kings would then not only be tied 2-2 in the season series, but would have exactly the same conference record, which is the next tiebreaker. So it would be too close to call and all the way down to the wire on that one, presumably. But
look at the Kings schedule, right? So after these two, they go to Utah, and then they have Clippers, Knicks, Boston, Brooklyn, OKC, New Orleans, Phoenix, Portland. You know, that's a tough schedule for them down the stretch. And they've been up and down, but you're playing in an arena that's really tough to win. You know, this is just, look, all along, we've been looking at these two games. Jason Kidd has been stopping everybody, saying we got to play the game in front of us. We got to play the game in front. Well, the game's in front of us tonight.
Yes,
first one of that. It's on TNT. Everybody can watch it tonight, and then obviously Friday. I believe is that an ABC game, Channel 8 game?
Yeah, that's a WFAA Dallas.
Okay,
Mavericks
so that'll be great.
Network. Yep,
huge game there, and of course you can listen to Chuck and I if you're driving around as well Tuesday or Friday, but. You know, it can't get any better, bigger than these two games right here, Mark. And they're going to have huge implications of whether we're playing a play-in game or a playoff game come mid-April.
And as you said, I think, you know, look, it's a very, very big ask to go in there and win both games. If you split, the downside to that is then Sacramento obviously has the tiebreaker with a 3-1 season series advantage. However, you're tied, you don't gain any ground, you don't lose any ground, and then it becomes a 9-game race to the finish with Sacramento having a tougher schedule than Dallas. Now, before we get done, the Mavericks schedule has gotten tougher based on what's going on with the Rockets and how well they're playing as of late. A note on them in a moment. But as we drill down just a little bit tonight on Sacramento, Brian, I think the story with the Kings is, to your point, number one, they have been wildly inconsistent this year. They've had some fantastic wins. They're also one of three teams in the league this year that have lost to the trio of the Wizards, Hornets, and Pistons. And obviously, they're an outlier. The other two teams are not good teams. The Kings are a good team, but they've lost to all three of those teams who are amongst the worst records in the league this year. So that gives you... an indication that they have a high ceiling, but they also have a pretty low floor when they're not on their game this year. But the guy to watch tonight from the Sacramento perspective, Brian, of course, is Domantas Sabonis. Last night in a win over Philadelphia, Sabonis had another double-double in that game. He now has had 54 consecutive double-doubles, which is the longest streak in the post-NBA-ABA merger era since 1976. He surpassed Kevin Love, who had 53 consecutive. Sabonis has 54 straight double-doubles. And in two games at American Airlines Center against the Mavs this year, here are the numbers for Sabonis, Brian. 24.5 points per game, 12 rebounds per game. Hasn't hurt them with the pass a lot, 5 assists per game. But he's gone 20 of 25 from the floor. That's 80%. I know you have an MBA, but I know you need your help with math, Brian. That's 80% that Sabonis has shot in two games against Dallas this year.
Well, realize, though, this is a different Mavericks team. And
yep,
they're bigger,
yep,
and they're longer, and they're more athletic. So the layup line, the open runway to the paint that Fox and Sabonis had in those first two games are going to be there now. And it's going to be interesting to see how this new-look Mavs team goes against a team that Sabonis just had his way in the middle at. He's great. Fox, obviously, in crunch time, can get inside in the lane and get where he wants to. We've seen that over and over again. I will tell you, what I'm disappointed at is that tonight there won't be a lady screaming right above you from right. your broadcast station. I believe that was Sacramento, wasn't
yeah,
it?
That's, yeah, that happened there last year in one of the games right after the Kyrie Irving trade, as a matter of fact. And by the way, not only did Sabonis have a double-double last night, he had a triple-double. 11 points, 13 boards, 10 assists, and their 12-point win over the 76ers. You know, watch tonight, Brian. Sacramento runs dribble handoffs on offense far yes. more than any yes. team in the league. When I brought that up to Jay Kidd earlier this year, he said Kevin Herter is a player that you have to watch. However, Herter yes. is injured right now. So right. Keon Ellis has moved into the starting lineup. But he's just kind of a—I mean, he did play 24 minutes last night, but I feel like in a lot of ways, Ellis is a bit of a placeholder starter. And then they bring Malik Monk in off the bench, and, you know, they get contributions off the bench. Chris Duarte plays a decent number of minutes. And Davion Mitchell, by the way, had a really nice game. Former Baylor Bear, member of the national championship team, Brian. He had 18 points off the bench. Keegan Murray is probably getting some more shots in the flow of their offense now with the injury to Kevin Herter. And we've discussed this whole thing without talking about De'Aaron Fox, who, you know, Sabonis is the fulcrum and the engine of their offense. But Fox, of course, is a guy who's already been an all-star in his young career and is a handful to deal with as well. So these are two tough games. By the way, the Rockets have now won 9 in a row, and that's going to be the last game of the week. Before we do our next podcast, that'll be on Sunday, Brian. They've got a visit to American Airlines Center on the following Sunday. So there's two more games that Dallas has to play against the Rockets. I don't think that's necessarily a standings thing in terms of Houston catching Dallas, but it is, you know, just you have to win every game
but
you possibly
Houston
can.
Is, Houston's gunning for the play-in.
Yes,
there's
exactly.
no question about it.
Yeah, these are not cakewalk
well.
Games. Against
and
them.
They are playing, you know, a lot of these winning has come without Şengün in there in the middle. And
that's right.
So,
matter of fact, Şengün got hurt, Brian, in a game where they went out to Sacramento and won as part of this 9-game winning streak. A victory in Sacramento, Şengün got hurt. But as you said, they've, you know, Jalen Green was just recently player of the week in the Western Conference, and he's been a big factor in what Houston's doing. So this is, two huge games and another one over the weekend, Brian. This is big time stuff right now. It's a long season, but now this is where the rubber meets the road, as they say.
It's huge. I'm looking forward to tonight yep. on TNT. I'm looking forward to having you up here Friday.
Yep.
Huge game Sunday, and then in Houston.
Yep.
And then
we'll get to see your
Monday.
Unmade bed in San Francisco next week. We'll
yes.
do the podcast on Monday. On Monday, we'll do the podcast in San Francisco whenever the Mavs are getting ready to play a game on the road next week against the Golden State Warriors. However, with that, we are done. This is Take That With You, presented by NTTA. For Brian Dameris, I'm Mark Followill. Thanks to Chop, thanks to Kat, thanks to Bobby, the whole Mavs Studio 41 crew for pitching in today. And we will see you next week with another episode of Take That With You.